My name is Michael, and all these slides are going to be online, so don't feel any need to take any notes unless you want to. We're going to start by going over what Bitcoin is, how the protocol works, and then we have a better understanding of how it works. We can look at some of the things that are and are not possible. So first, just for starting out, Bitcoin's pretty confusing. Nobody really understands how the protocol works at first, and you kind of have to start with approximations that are mostly accurate, and then as you dig into the details, you find, oh, there's an exception here, or it works a little bit differently there. So that's how we'll do it today. And it has these weird catchphrases. You'll hear people throw around the internet of money. I personally really like nerd gold. I think that's good. But Bitcoin is unusual. So why does it exist? It has these amazing benefits. It can't be counterfeit. It's easy to verify. Even on a free wallet on your phone, you can prove that your Bitcoin is valid, and we'll show what that looks like. It's scarce. There will only ever be 21 million. It's portable. You can send it across the world. It's divisible, so don't feel the need like you have to have one Bitcoin. You can transact in 100 millionth of a Bitcoin. That's a Satoshi. And it's censorship resistant, which is sort of a new property of money. But if you can't really know that somebody has something and they're not physically carrying it, then it's very hard to stop a transaction or take someone's Bitcoin. So as we go through Bitcoin, you'll learn that the names are even more confusing. So if it's Bitcoin with a capital B, it's the protocol. If it's Bitcoin with a lowercase b, it's the currency. There are no coins in Bitcoin, although you'll see coin in every like startup in the cryptocurrency space, Bit or Coin. And wallets are actually keychains. So if you're familiar with what that means, that distinction will make sense. So in order to understand how Bitcoin works, you have to understand a little bit about cryptography. What's surprising about Bitcoin is that there is no new cryptography. There's actually no new technology in Bitcoin. Everything in Bitcoin is really old. And one of the amazing things about Bitcoin, there's no reason that somebody didn't invent it 10 years sooner. It's kind of surprising from my perspective that it took so long. Of course, now it's like this amazing thing. Okay, so first, let's talk about asymmetric cryptography or public-private key cryptography. Private keys are what you use to sign the message. In Bitcoin, it's a number between 1 and 2 to the 256. That is a really, really big number. That's way more than there are atoms in the universe. Anyone with your public key can verify that the person who signed the message was holding the private key. So that's really important. That means if you sign a message, anyone can verify, hey, you really did sign this message. But that signed message does not reveal your secret key or your private key. And that's a really impressive property. If you think of signing a check, anyone who's looking at that can see your signature. And it doesn't have this tamper-proof feature, so if somebody were to change the check and make it for $1,000 instead of $100, the signature is still totally valid. But with an asymmetric cryptography signature, that property is not true anymore. You're signing the exact thing, so there's no way to tamper with it. And there's some really cool non-Bitcoin uses for this that we ignore. But the original use case for this was like, I'm going to publish my public key, you're going to send me a message encrypted with that public key, and only me, the holder of the corresponding private key, can decrypt. Bitcoin doesn't use that. So, aside. Another thing that's really important to understand for Bitcoin, one of the primitives is hash functions. These are sometimes called one-way functions. Hash function has four properties. If I'm interviewing a software engineer with a cryptography background, this is my warm-up question. What are the four properties of a hash function? The public key B owns that Bitcoin, and the private key for B signed. So we can't say whether that was a legitimate signature, like maybe someone stole your private key, maybe it was on an exchange that got hacked, but we can say it's a valid signature, and that's all the Bitcoin network cares about. Another way to look at this is that there's no concept of being able to reverse a transaction, because all the Bitcoin protocol knows is, was the signature valid? That could be a great feature. If you're a merchant and someone pays for something, you know you have settlement finality. So that's really good. You can go about your business without worrying about getting a chargeback next month. If you're a user and your wallet gets hacked and your money's gone, you really wish you could charge that back. So it's something that's different. I think it's a feature, but it depends how you look at it. So what gets put in these blocks? And each transaction gets identified by its hash. The more you learn about the Bitcoin protocol, its hash is all the way down. And the transactions are packaged into one Merkle root. And a Merkle root is just the hashing of a bunch of different transactions. It's a very cool data structure. It's O of log n in both time and space for looking up set inclusion. So you can do crazy things with like light client wallets. So your phone can prove that a Bitcoin transaction existed on the blockchain, even though your phone cannot hold the 200 gigabytes of blockchain data or process every transaction. You can just look at tiny slices. But a Merkle root, you can think of it as just a hash of all the transactions. And the blocks are linked in the blockchain in an order to prevent double spending. So each block points to the previous block. So if we look at an example of a block, we have a bunch of transaction IDs. Remember, these resemble randomness and dot, dot, dot. And the current Bitcoin, well, currently there's a little change that makes it more complicated, but originally there was only 1 megabyte of transaction data. So you know, each of these is the hash of more data, but that was the limit of those transactions, about 4 per second. And then this is the Merkle root, that's just the hash of this. And this is the previous block that we're pointing to. So it's like a linked list, each block building on the previous block, pointing to the previous one. One of the cool things about this is that it becomes tamper-proof. So if I know the previous block hash was this, and you know the previous block hash was that same value, we know that all of our history going back to the inception of this blockchain is the same. Every single transaction is captured by that, because we're about to see why, actually. And I did leave out some implementation things. Yes?
Can one transaction be kept in multiple blocks?
No. So one of the consensus rules is a transaction only occurs once, and when it does, the inputs get destroyed and the outputs get created. So you can think of it as like, if you paid me, so right now, if I was charging $8, you might give me a 10 and I might give you 2 back. In Bitcoin land, the numbers could be anything. So let's say something was 8 millibitcoin, you might pay me 9 and I might give you 1 back. So your 10. So we just store this transaction data, but if you have a whole record of the blockchain, you could go look up this transaction. And so basically you would say, okay, here's this transaction. There's a way that you fetch it. We'll keep the gossip network and how the network communication works separately, but you fetch this transaction data, and then you say, I'm looking at my copy of the blockchain, is each of these inputs available to be spent? And by available, I mean, is it an unspent transaction output from the previous transaction? If it's available to be spent, great, I'll spend it, but if it's not available, then this is an invalid transaction, I'll reject the whole block. And there's a reason why you really don't want to have your whole block rejected. So let's go a little bit forward, and then if this doesn't make sense, I'll come back and clarify, because there's still a couple other moving pieces. So this is the important stuff that's in a block. There's some other things. And what proof of work does, which is this magical way that Bitcoin solves this problem, is that you add a nonce to the block header, and you're looking for one that if you hash all of these things, the Merkle root, which is just the transaction I use, and the previous block hash, and the nonce, and you hash that, you get a hash with a bunch of leading zeros. Now you can just think about this, that would be really hard to do, because on average, since the hash produces a uniform distribution, it's seemingly random. Well, there's a 1 in 16 chance that you're gonna get one that starts with 1, 0. And then there's a 1 in 16 squared chance that you're gonna get one with 2 leading zeros. 16 cubed, 16 to the fourth, 16 to the fifth, 16 to the sixth. You're gonna have to guess a lot of times. And so what's happening is, every miner on the network is trying lots and lots of nonces. And eventually, somebody's gonna find one that has enough difficulty, which you can think of as enough leading zeros. It actually goes to more than just the zero. There's a target difficulty that's getting recalculated. And if you find that, you win the block. So that is how proof of work works. But the network has to adjust difficulty. So the block time is supposed to be 10 minutes. Yes?
So when you say you win the block, means you keep the transaction, like you're keeping the track of the transaction after that?
So you get the right to publish the next block, and you get all the transaction fees that were paid in that block, and you also get a reward. It's called the Coinbase, which that's where Coinbase got their name. Now people call it the block reward because it's too confusing. But you get a block reward. Currently in Bitcoin, that's 12.5 Bitcoin per block. So it's a big reward. I mean, if a Bitcoin's worth roughly $10,000, 12.5 Bitcoin is a big chunk of money. So you really want that reward. That's why you have all these people trying to do this. So So the average block time on the network is targeted for 10 minutes. That's an arbitrary parameter that was set on day one. And so that means if you broadcast your transaction out to the network and it pays a high enough fee that miners say, ooh, I want to include that transaction, on average, it's going to be 10 minutes until you make it into the next block. When its block times are falling because more people are mining on the network and the collective hash power is able to solve that problem quicker, the difficulty increases. So you can think of that as adding more zeros to the front. And then we calculate the average block discovery time every trailing 2 weeks. So it's a backwards looking metric where we're always readjusting. And typically, because hash power keeps coming onto the network, we're readjusting and saying, oops, we gotta make difficulty more. And you'll see hash power is going way up, difficulty is going way up. So the longest block becomes an unfakeable thing because you have to do so much work. We consider six confirmations to be incredibly safe. This is in the original Satoshi white paper. Satoshi is the inventor of Bitcoin. And they specified why you get security properties based on how much hash power an adversary has. Because a dishonest party makes more money mining transactions than they do being dishonest. So as long as 51% of people are honest, the dishonest party will eventually lose. So after six confirmations, it's considered incredibly safe. Somebody would have to solve that problem six times to rewind history. And everyone can see on the network how much work has been done. You can validate that really, really easily because you just do that one quick hash function and you say, yes, the work is valid, and wow, that must have been hard to calculate. Maybe you got lucky once, but not six times. So transactions are never really confirmed. This is a different concept than like your bank account where you log in and hit send and it says pending and then it says confirmed. Bitcoin just builds more blocks on top. At six, we say, like, you know, if you were selling a Ferrari, you'd let the guy drive away with it because you've got six confirmations. This is a somewhat arbitrary point that just says, well, if you're, I think six means your attacker has like less than 10% of the network hash power and you want to be 99.99% sure. And they're actively attacking you. So it's all pretty unlikely, but you can set your parameters wherever you want to. So this block reward is what sets the money supply. So right now the block reward is 25 Bitcoin per block. Yes?
Is there any centralized agency which keeps track of all the transactions?
No. So there's no centralized agency keeping track of all the transactions, but you could run a full node that would. And I don't mean this like hypothetically. Like if you want to go home tonight and run the software, it's free. And you could sync the blockchain, and you could watch all this stuff happen. You could even like run your own block explorer locally to have a UI for it. There's really cool things if you run your own software, because if you're validating every transaction, you can look at which transactions are yours, and no one can see that. Whereas if you query a third-party service and you say, hey, I really care about the transactions belonging to this public key, you kind of just said which address is yours. Like maybe you just happen to be curious about that one, but most likely that pattern just revealed who you are. But if you run your own software and you have access to the whole blockchain, you can query your own computer and say, hey, what's the balance on address A, or show me the transactions that I've spent on address B. But you can download this and you can verify this. And this is one of the most important consensus rules in Bitcoin. This emission schedule is arbitrary. It's what Satoshi picked. Every 4 years, the block reward falls in half. So it fell, it was like a year and a half ago, to 12 and a half. That was a big event. It'll fall to 6.25 in a couple more years. And we know all the way out what the supply will be, and we can see it looks roughly asymptotic. I don't think this was a perfect design choice, because we have these huge adjustment points. We're doing it over again, maybe it would be a little smoother. But the beauty is there's no unexpected inflation here. We all know exactly what the schedule is. And if any miner tried to cheat and say, oh, give me 1,000 Bitcoin for this block, everyone else would orphan them. They'd say, that's invalid, and the system only works if 51% of us are honest, so I'm not going to accept that. And in practice, this works. So the transactions are free, and I put free in air quotes, because the miners decide whether to include you in their block. And so if there's other people who are paying a higher transaction fee, well, they're not going to include that free transaction. And in practice, there's a minimum in order to be relayed. But you might have a relationship with a mining pool, or you might be a miner, in which case you can include a free transaction that's totally valid. The transaction fees are currently only 5% of miner revenue. Like a month ago, we had transaction fees spiking, and we had at least a couple blocks where the transaction fee revenue was greater than the block reward. So it is possible for this number to increase quite a bit. In the long term, it probably will. Another cost is that predictable inflation schedule. Bitcoin is at about 4% this year, and it's falling. But again, the higher transaction fees get included faster in blocks. And this is sort of like a natural competition or marketplace for space in the blockchain. So the network hash power is absolutely exploding. I made this presentation in 2014, and I've updated a very little of it because the tech part doesn't change. This graph from 2014 looks like this. Today I went to pull the latest one from blockchain.info. It looks exactly like this. 2014 is like this. It just keeps going. It's just more people competing for Bitcoin. You can think of it as roughly analogous to a indicator of the price. If Bitcoin's price goes up, then I want to mine it more. If Bitcoin's price were to go down, I might decide it wasn't worth the electrical costs anymore to run some of my hardware, and I might stop running it. So there are some serious scaling problems of any blockchain system. The first is hard drive. So Bitcoin is currently 195 gigabytes, and it's still growing. For point of comparison, I think Ether is around 250, but that's a much newer blockchain. So it is growing much, much faster. So double spends was one that you brought up, but also the consensus rules. Did somebody give themselves 1,000 Bitcoin when they mined a block? That would make it invalid. So checking all that is actually resource intensive. And that's part of the trade-off with Bitcoin. You want the blocks to be big so everyone can participate, but you want them to be small so everyone can run a node. So here are some of the things that Bitcoin does to help solve scale. The first one is libsecp256k1. Secp256k1 is the specific curve that Bitcoin uses for ECDSA for signing. And previously, in the first version that Satoshi wrote, we were using OpenSSL, and it's just not very fast. Libsecp256k1 was like a five-fold speed up, so that makes those signature verifications much faster. We switched to compressed keys in 2012, that was, and that saves a little bit of space. Auth return is a way to embed data in the blockchain where people can effectively throw it out if they don't want to hold on to it, because it's just random data that you're embedding that's not related to transactions. Blocks only in version 0.12 of Bitcoin says, just give me the block. I don't need to be sharing all the transaction data in real time. Just tell me what makes it to the block. That's like a two-thirds reduction in data. SegWit is the new, really controversial thing in Bitcoin, new like last summer. And you separate signatures from transactions. So you're segregating the witness. That's what SegWit comes from. And this solves some other cool problems like malleability and does script versioning, does lots of cool things. But it also helps with scale because they soft forked in a doubling of the block size, the extension block. So that's like a separate block. It's a separate data structure that the original Bitcoin nodes can ignore safely. Payment channels are coming soon to mainnet. These are incredibly cool. Payment channels have been around for a long while. And a payment channel is you can think of going to a bar, and you want to, I don't know if you guys are 21 or not. I have to give a different example here. You're buying some internet access, and maybe you're going to constantly be metering out your payment. You might put down your credit card number, and it's going to say, okay, it's this much per hour or this much per megabyte. And at the end of your hours or megabytes of downloading, it charges your credit card at once. So the only charge that goes on your credit card account is like, you know, $5 for internet. You don't see that this was actually this many packets sent across the wire over this much time. A payment channel is the same thing. I open up a channel with a counterparty and I keep paying them. But I use some magic cryptographic tricks where we can't steal from each other. So they don't get to charge my credit card $100. incrementally giving them a signing over value, but we only broadcast to the transaction to the blockchain at the end. What's really magical about the Lightning Network is you can do these payment channels across multiple hops. So Alice can pay Bob, who can pay Charlie, who can pay David, all via Lightning Network payments, and none of them hit the blockchain. But maybe after the 1,000th payment, somebody wants to close a channel, and that's fine. And you don't have to route Alice, Bob, Charlie, David. You could route to any open person or entity that you had a payment channel with. You could establish channels with as many people as you wanted. So then we have lots and lots of payments happening, but very few hitting the blockchain that everyone needs to validate. So that's a cool development that's happening now. There's an obvious one, which is to increase the block size. You get more transactions, but you don't solve the scaling problems. And then we see a lot of this is off-chain transactions. Let's say I have a Coinbase account, you have a Coinbase account, I can pay you on Coinbase, say $10, and there's no fee for that at all. And it's also instant. The problem is, I only have a Bitcoin IOU on Coinbase, and now you have my Bitcoin IOU on Coinbase, but neither of us really has Bitcoin. We don't have a private key, we can't sign a transaction. We're trusting that when you go to do your transaction on Coinbase, they'll let you spend it. And they're in the business of doing that, they're usually pretty good about it. But if you should be involved in, say, the cannabis industry, you might get your account frozen. Coinbase kind of solves that problem in some use cases. Also, we both have to have Coinbase. You might be a Gemini user, I'm a Coinbase user. Now we can't transact. There are services like ChangeTip on Reddit where you could say, like, all right, send this guy, $2 for something, and it would credit him, but it's the same thing. It's all off blockchain. You're just trusting that when you go to redeem it, they'll have that money and they'll credit it to you. And then altcoins have become super popular. So there's thousands of Bitcoin clones or forks, and you can transact on them, and that doesn't blow up Bitcoin's blockchain at all. But then the same problem, we both have to have a Bitcoin Cash or Litecoin or Dogecoin or Feathercoin or whichever one. We blow up their blockchains. Okay, so this is where, if you have a basic understanding of what Bitcoin does, how it works, you can see about how it's often misunderstood. So these are some popular Bitcoin myths, and I would say this is the warning part where this is where it starts to get political. Feel free to interrupt with questions anytime. So a common misconception with Bitcoin is that it's anonymous, and that's not true. Anyone can look at the blockchain and see all of transactions for all of time. So the correct word is that Bitcoin is pseudonymous. And we have these short-lived identities that are Bitcoin addresses. They should be short-lived. You should not reuse them. In practice, some people do. They just say, hey, I have one address. And everyone who sends me money, send to this one address. But because it's free to create these address, public-private key pair address, public-private key pairs, and the public keys, we can think of it as the address, because it's free to create this, you should use a different one for every transaction. So you can kind of piece together identity by seeing who you transact with. And I like to say that Bitcoin is as anonymous as you want it to be, but the default setting is not very anonymous. It is very hard to do all the things right. We talked before about running your own full node software so that you can see which transactions you care about, but nobody else can. And you should really be running that full node software behind something like Tor, so that people can't even know who you are. You don't want to be known as the first source that broadcasts a transaction to address A. You might be the owner of address A. So that's a good example. And it requires great effort and expertise to be anonymous. The really easy to use light clients that I do recommend, and I'll show you at the end my website. I wrote a blog post on how to store Bitcoin and all the different ways you can do it. Those easy light clients will reveal some of your privacy. So it's a very hard trade-off. This was a quote I really liked from Mark Andreessen, when he said in 2014, that libertarians will turn on Bitcoin. Bitcoin is thought of as like a super pro-libertarian thing, but it actually enables everyone to see what you're doing with your transactions, which may or may not be a good thing, depends on your perspective. A common one you hear is that a 51% attack will destroy Bitcoin. So that's when an entity gets 51% of the hash power on the network, and they're able to do some malicious things. So the most obvious venue for this is mining pools. So instead of mining individually, I might pool my mining equipment with other miners. And the benefit of this is a smooth income. So if I'm a miner and I know that it is incredibly hard to find a block, and I invest $100 in mining equipment, the number of blocks I'm likely to find over the course of that mining equipment and hardware's lifetime is zero. It's not a good investment. There is a chance I might find a block worth 12.5 Bitcoin, and then all of a sudden, I'm sitting on like $125,000 for my $100 investment. But most of the time, I'm just gonna lose all my money. And that's not a very good way to make an investment. I'd rather make the $100 investment and then every month get paid $20 or, you know, slightly less as my hardware becomes less competitive and have a smooth earning potential. So what happens is small miners like that pool with other miners. And you get these big pools that are really, really good at scale. They're good at relaying blockchain information quickly and validating. They have great uptime. They run the latest software for you. But now a pool might control 20% of the hash power on the network. So what if they collude? Well, it's important to remember that the mining pools do not own the hardware. They're just having users you can think of as elect to use them out of convenience. And those users are pointing their hash power at the pool. So if that pool ever behaves badly, they're going to lose that hash power. People wouldn't want to support it. But you know, that's not totally trustless. So let's say there was a 51% attack. It could definitely harm the price of Bitcoin. No one would want to buy Bitcoin if there wasn't confidence in the security provided by the miners. But it's really difficult to profit from. First of all, it requires an enormous investment in hardware. At this point, with Bitcoin's difficulty, we're talking about in the billions of dollars. So maybe a government, like the US government, could pull that off, or the Chinese government. But it's definitely outside the scope of what, like, a hedge fund could do if they wanted to fund Bitcoin. And you still can't sign transactions if you don't have the private keys. So you remember when we looked before at what's in a Bitcoin block header, it's just a list of transactions. You can't make a transaction. The only thing you can do is refuse to include a transaction in a block. So you can think of this as like extorting someone to say, hey, if you want to spend your money, you got to pay me. But they can just wait. You know, this attack is very expensive for you to run. So in theory, you just wait it out. And it can also increase the time window for double spend attacks. So before, when I said six confirmations, that was an assumption of how much hash power your attacker has. If they have more hash power, you might want to wait more than six confirmations. But again, this is really something that you would do as a value judgment based on who you were transacting with. So, you know, if you're sending money to somebody as a regular business partner, you have a trusted working relationship together, they might say one confirmation, this person's not trying to attack me. I'll accept this, and if there's a problem, I'd call them up. You might say, like, hey, that's an adversary. I don't trust them for a second. I'm going to wait for 10 confirmations. And if you look at some altcoin trading exchanges, they do that because they have anonymous users who might try to double spend. So they wait for more confirmations. That's fine. Another common one you hear is that Bitcoin is deflationary. And that's not true. It is technically still inflationary. Remember, we've got 4% inflation or increase in the money supply this year. But it's expected, which is very different from traditional fiat currencies, and it slows down over time. And since the value has historically appreciated quite a bit over long time horizons, we think of that as deflationary. But it is not, it inflates. Another one you hear all the time is that Bitcoin is easy to correlate. And there are thousands of altcoins, but the market doesn't value them. They are more valued now than they ever have been. But I remember a time when everyone said PrimeCoin was going to take over, or BitShares was going to be huge, or FetherCoin was the future. And nobody talks like that anymore because those coins are not doing super well. The network effects in currency are massive. You want to hold the money that everyone else wants to hold, and you want the one that's the most liquid. But if another coin did surpass Bitcoin in value, it would be because people found it more useful. There's that. This is one of my favorites. Bitcoin is only for criminals. If anything's valuable, criminals are going to use it. They use cell phones, they use cars. We don't talk about those as being tools of criminals. But the US dollar is the original dark coin, and it's by far the most effective for criminals. If there's one message you guys can take away from today, since I know you're in college, don't buy drugs on the internet with Bitcoin. It's not good currency for that. So its features of the dollar is that it's universally accepted 100% anonymous. There are more $100 bills in circulation than $20 bills. People often don't believe that, but you can look it up on the Mint. It's just that they don't see the light of day. And most US bills already come with trace amounts of cocaine, so that's
what they're
saying.
Seriously?
Yeah. It's like, there's enough that if you collect like all of the bills that are currently in circulation, you'd have like almost a kilogram of cocaine on it. Like, but it'd take a lot, but it's very easy proof.
So another common complaint you hear about Bitcoin is that it has no intrinsic value. And that one's actually true, but no money does. Gold is shiny, but so is tinfoil. The US dollar is no longer tied to hard assets like gold. And the US dollar does have this one true thing that it is the only, it is required for payment for taxes. Although some tax authorities are now accepting payment in Bitcoin, which is pretty cool. And there are payment processors that if you pay them in Bitcoin, they'll pay your taxes. The US dollar does have this thing that the military could enforce a contract against the foreign government. But since we're debtors, that's probably pretty unlikely. Another common complaint is that Bitcoin is too volatile. And volatility only matters if you choose to hold it. So if you're using it as a payment mechanism, your volatility is constrained to your duration of exposure. If you're only holding Bitcoin for 2 hours, you're only exposed to the price for 2 hours. That there's not so much volatility in. The volatility has been decreasing over time, although this last year has been a wild ride. And you do have a positive price trend. So, you know, if I'm looking at holding something that's volatile and going up versus like the US dollar that's very steadily going down 2% per year, I'm comfortable with that. But not everyone is, it doesn't work for every use case. But there is no way to go from being worth nothing to replacing gold, worth about $8 trillion, without massive volatility. You can't go up smoothly in that. So if you believe that it's successful, you accept that there's massive volatility. This is one of my favorites. Bitcoin is a Ponzi scheme. There's two major differences with Bitcoin between traditional Ponzi scheme.
What's a Ponzi scheme?
Oh, so Ponzi scheme was named after this guy named Alfred Ponzi. A horrible thing to be famous for, where he basically took investor money and promised them great returns. And new investors sign up and bring new money in, and he pays off the old investors with the new investors' money. You can think of it as like pyramid scheme. The problem is you have to keep getting new investors in, otherwise the whole thing collapses. But there's two major differences from Ponzi schemes with Bitcoin. One, it rebounds from crashes. Ponzi schemes collapse under pressure. Nobody rushes in to buy a Ponzi scheme. Ponzi schemes are centrally managed. There's a single entity that is profiting off of this. A Bernie Madoff, if you will, is a great example. In Bitcoin, there is no central entity. And now we're definitely the politics. Bitcoin needs regulation. Thanks to the government, we stopped Bernie Madoff in the housing crisis. You can't regulate the math behind the protocol. So that's the most important thing. But you can regulate the on-ramps and the off-ramps. So your Coinbase, Gemini, Kraken, these are entities that are companies that have bank accounts, and they can be compelled to do things. And unfortunately, that's keeping out many good actors and pushing Bitcoin companies overseas. If you go to some Bitcoin company's website and you're a New York resident, it'll redirect you to a page saying, sorry, this website is banned in New York and North Korea. Please talk to your representative. A common complaint is that governments will ban Bitcoin. This is less common now, but if you go back in time 4 years, everyone was saying it'll never be big because governments will ban it. And the only way to really stop Bitcoin would be to shut down the internet. It uses a peer-to-peer gossip protocol. You can kind of think of it as like BitTorrent. It's very, very hard to stop that without turning off the internet. You could make the penalties really, really stiff. And a classic example of this is Argentina, when they had capital controls a few years ago. And I was there and got to see this. And dollars were not supposed to be used for transactions, but you have roughly $40 billion under mattresses and in safe deposit boxes. So it's very hard to enforce this kind of thing. So a common question people ask is, who is Satoshi Nakamoto? That's the person, he, she, they, entity, organization that published the original Bitcoin white paper in 2008. The reality is, doesn't really matter. We don't know, but Bitcoin is decentralized. There's no individual that has control. Satoshi came back. They couldn't really do anything. Paul Graham, the famous startup investor, creator of Hacker News and Y Combinator, he said he thought it was the NSA. I don't think so, but who knows? And then you have lots of these altcoins. People have created many other coins. Ethereum is probably the most well-known one, and it has a decentralized contract platform that is Turing complete. Bitcoin scripting language is not Turing complete. Bitcoin does have a scripting language that allows powerful things like the Lightning Network, the famous like SHA-1 pinata was a cool script. But because of this, Ethereum has a super complex attack surface. So you see things like the DAO, 1 in 6 Ether addresses had funds in the DAO, and that got hacked, and they rolled back their blockchain and did a hard fork. Or the multi-sig wallet Parity that recently lost a ton of money. They're talking about doing another hard fork to bail those guys out. Monero is a really cool one that uses ring signatures with confidential transactions. It uses these range proofs, which is a required part of making the protocol work. And the range proofs are large. So it doesn't scale very well, but it's very cool. Zcash does it a different way, using ZK Snarks. That is like some crazy magic moon math. The transaction takes about 40 seconds to sign on like a quad core machine with 8 gigs of RAM. So forget about a mobile wallet. It has some other issues. There's a 20% founder reward. There's a trusted setup. It's backed by a private company, but it is pretty cool. Litecoin is a fork of Bitcoin, Dogecoin is a fork of Litecoin. There's also Ripple or XRP. This one's not really a cryptocurrency. It's run by a centralized company, it's controlled by them. So it's not really decentralized, it's not censorship resistant in any way. But it's worth a lot. So the big takeaway with these is just beware of the pump and dump schemes. In 2014, this had PrimeCoin, MasterCoin, and BitShares on it. Those would not have made good. So do your homework. Bitcoin is super risky. Don't put any money in it you can't afford to lose. But it may be the greatest technological innovation we've seen since the internet. And let's see. That's it. All these slides are up on my website. They're all free and everything. So we've got time for 15 minutes of questions, and then I'm happy to stick around after for more.
So you mentioned Ripple.
Yeah.
What are Ripple?
So this is pretty cool. So let's say we have a simple thing where you have 8 transactions. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And we want to package them into our blockchain. And this could be a much, much larger number, so this will seem a little complex, but it will be very cool. If I want proof that my transaction was included in this group of 8, without having to know all 8, what's a way we could do that set inclusion? And a Merkle proof is one of them. So a Merkle proof says we're going to hash together every pair at the bottom, and that's going to give us, this is like hash 1, 2, hash 2, 3, or sorry, 3, 4, hash 4, 5. So we're going to go up and hash this way. There's something we do for the odd number edge case, just pretend it's even for simplicity. And then we'll go up once again. So this will be hash 1, 2, 3, 4, and hash 5, 6, 7, 8. And so that's again by hashing these things together. And then if we hash this together, we get the Merkle root. So in our slide, we have the Merkle root. And now if you want to prove inclusion, I just need to supply, if we want to say 2 was included, I need to show 1 and 2, and I can calculate this hash. Then I need to show the hash of 3, 4, and I can calculate this hash. And then I need to show the hash of 5, 6, 7, 8, and I can calculate the Merkle root. And if you think about that, that's log n in terms of your big O notation in both time and space complexity. So this could get really big, and it's not that many hops. And so that block header from before, because Bitcoin blocks are every 10 minutes, and that header is so small, block headers are about 5 megabytes per year. It's really small data. You could download a free wallet on your phone, like Red Wallet or Mycelium, that tracks the block headers only. And in that block header is the Merkle root. So you could query a server and say, hey, have you seen any transactions for address A? And it would say, yes, I have. I saw transaction 2. And you say, great, prove it to me. And it would say, sure, here's the data you need to show you proof that you've been included. And that cannot be fake. So that's really neat. One thing to keep in mind about this, there is no proof of exclusion. So it would be possible for an SPV server, this is called simplified payment verification, it would be possible for an SPV server to say, oh no, haven't seen any transactions involving address A. And you can't know they're not telling the truth. So there's a slightly different security model. If they give you proof of inclusion, you know that the transaction was included. If they don't, you just don't know. But SPV is usually used for receiving transactions. So you would say, prove that I've received this money, and until I get that proof, I'm not going to let you drive off with my car. So you can just sort of wait it out until somebody gives you the proof. You'll also notice, if you look at this, that this is a DOS vector. Because I just said, ask for a tiny bit of data. I said, give me transactions for address A. And the server had to calculate all of this and serve me all of this back. And remember, this could be many, many levels deep. And so anytime you can send a small amount of data over the wire and require a server to do a large amount of computation, you have a DOS vector. It is amazing that SPV nodes stay online. Don't get any bad ideas, though. They're a great service to the network.
So does that represent a block right there?
Yes, so if you go back to our slide, I cut some things out that are not as interesting, but this is a block header. So all we had to have was the Merkle root. We don't actually need all the transaction IDs, because they're, you think of represented by just this, and our previous block, because we're pointing to the previous block, because this is like a linked list of blocks. The nonce that was used to calculate this hash, we could just calculate it. We don't need to store it. So that's it. There's also a timestamp. There's a version. We don't actually, this nonce is too small. They didn't reserve enough bytes for how much hash power we have. So what people do is they take the first transaction here and they stuff some junk into the first output, and that updates the Merkle root, and that's the way they get their source of randomness, which is very annoying. So there's like a lot of hacks on Bitcoin. Bitcoin is like a hack built on a nasty hack built on a nasty hack. If you could do it all over again, you'd make it much, much cleaner.
So if I'm trying to verify the transaction, it would be like a linkless kind of thing. You have to jump from one block to one block to one block until another is found the transaction.
Yes. So if you did not optimize your data structure at all, you'd have to look all the way back to see it. In practice, a Bitcoin node has everything nicely indexed. So when I see a transaction and it's spending, so I didn't really go over what's in the actual transaction structure. Each transaction has a list of inputs and a list of outputs. So this hash here represents the serialized form of a transaction. When you deserialize it, you see all the inputs and all the outputs. For each input, it says, here's the previous transaction hash and output index. Go look it up on the blockchain. So validating the transactions is kind of expensive because you can only do this serially. I can verify a lot of signatures in parallel. That's a thing I could do in multi-threaded processing if I had multiple. But if I want to see, is this transaction valid? Was this double spent? I can only look one transaction at a time. Because two transactions might be spending the same input, and if I was looking at them on two different cores, well, they'd both say they were good, but then I'd write them both to blockchain. So this process of looking up in blockchain history has to be single thread. It's our bottleneck. That's why we don't scale. Well, why we don't scale well.
So as a miner, our job is to find that hash after nonce, right?
Yes.
And that's the puzzle of the problem.
Yeah.
You're solving.
Yeah, people often refer to it as a math problem, and it's like, not really, you're just guessing.
Okay.
Like.
And as a miner, do we also like verify a transaction, like validate a transaction?
So you're doing a couple things. You're picking which transactions to include. You might say, oh, I don't like this guy, not including him. Yeah. you might say, oh, I'm only including transactions from my mining pool. You're probably just going to say, I'm just going to include the transactions that pay me the most. Now, that's what I would do if I was a miner. And if I was using a mining pool, I would not use one unless it paid me the most. But you get to pick which transactions in which order to include. And so from that, you calculate a Merkle root. And then from that, you start doing the nuts. But to your question about validity, let's say I picked a transaction that was invalid, maybe one that was spending an input, an output that had already been consumed. When I get a broadcast of this to the network, I say, look, I found a nuts, and I've got all these transactions and everything. Somebody else, another miner who's considering whether to build on top of that block, is going to say, no, you didn't. This is invalid. And it's not a human process. No one's like saying, oh, let me evaluate how I feel about this. It's running 24/7. It just says, I have my consensus rules. This violates them. This is garbage. And in fact, it's also going to block its connection to you. Because it thinks you're a DOS vector. You just sent it a bunch of garbage, made it do a bunch of work. So the consensus rules that these miners run are super important. And that's why these debates about, you know, what Bitcoin should do become so hotly contested. Because that's the point where the decision actually is manifested. So if you run a version of the software that allows bigger blocks, you can do that. But when you broadcast that block to other people, they will reject it and ban you.
So I want to have another question here.
Yeah.
So you said you work on economics and all, like you had a degree in economics. So I
yes.
want to understand it from an economics perspective. So you said today one Bitcoin value is $10,000.
Yeah, the exact value I think is maybe 10,500, but
so,
a lot of volatility.
Yeah. So whenever that you say the currency $1 is this much Indian rupees or this much Chinese currency, whatever
yeah.
that is, it depends on the purchasing parity of those things. Like you can buy, there is a parity, and it, from there you can derive how much dollar is how much euro, how much Chinese yen.
So I'm literally just looking at what the exchange of that country would pay. So like if you were to go on Coinbase, but it's not necessarily about purchasing power parity. It's a market exchange rate.
Yeah, like it depends on the country and how they operate and whatever.
Yeah.
So if this is decentralized, and here we have our own agreement between different kind of nodes, and they are just for doing a transaction and they are doing like that, how do you derive at $10,000 or how do you get that conversion rate in dollars?
Yeah, so the conversion rate is entirely outside the Bitcoin protocol. Bitcoin protocol has no idea what one Bitcoin works, what one Bitcoin is worth. And you'll often see tweets, when the price is going up or when the price is going down, people will joke, remember, one Bitcoin equals one Bitcoin. That's the conversion rate that people sometimes joke about, because you just don't know. You can kind of see it in the difficulty, because if the price of Bitcoin goes up, then there's an incentive for more people to mine. If more people are mining, then you have to adjust the difficulty upward, otherwise blocks get found too quickly. So like maybe you could intuit a price, but a mining equipment, you might put in your order 6 months in advance before you got your new hardware. So it's not this perfect system where the price is always up to the second adjusting. The hardware is actually the hard component. The electricity is the much smaller cost. So yeah, you just don't know what it's worth. All you can say is that this many Bitcoin move. You have no idea how much dollar, yen, or rupee that represents, or even if that person was in a country that touches one of those currencies. Maybe they're a peso person. Yeah.
Can you talk about combined all the miners who use a lot of electricity to solve quote unquote useless problems since they're basically just guessing a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So one alternative that I've heard is that instead of doing this whole nonce and hash thing is that they solve some other kind of difficult problem, like protein folding or something like that.
Yeah, so one of the unfortunate things is that the work has to be thrown away. And there's a reason why that we could show this pretty straightforward. If the work wasn't, so by that I mean that you're mining on top of this previous block hash. You can't know that in advance. If I knew what the block was going to look like in a week from now, in other words, I knew I was mining on block hash X in a week from now, I'd start on it today. And then when block hash X was revealed on the network, of course I'd be the first one to mine the next block because I would know it. So something like protein folding that serves a real use in the real world will fail one of two tests. One, I'm able to start doing the work early. Or two, the other thing about this I should have said first is this is really hard to do and really easy to verify. I should probably make that the byline of this slide. So in order to do this work, I had to guess that many nonces. I mean, so hard. In order to verify it, you can do this on your cell phone in less than 100 milliseconds. And the protein folding example, how do I know that you really did calculations for one computer for 1 year? I can't really know. This is very easy to verify. So when you're looking at a real-world application, those are the issues that you run into. There are other scarce resources you can prove you spent. So Ethereum is talking about moving to proof of stake. And stake, the most simple way to think of it is to think of spending coin age. So if I have a Bitcoin that I've held for 1 year, and then I spend it, let's say I have Bitcoin and I hold it for 1 day and I spend it. The expression is that I destroyed one Bitcoin day. In other words, that is just a number of Bitcoin times number of days, and now that I've spent it, it's now 0 days old. So you could do that math in many ways. I could have 0.01 Bitcoin that I held for 100 days, the day that I spend it. When I go spend it, that's one Bitcoin day destroyed. You could measure on coin age, and that's effectively what proof of stake is trying to do. You're trying to say, I own some chunk of this currency, and I've held it for some amount of time, so that gives me the right to be a validator. It suffers from a whole host of problems, but there are other ways you could do that with stake. There's other ways you could do it with space, but that's harder. This is really easy to verify, and it's really straightforward, because you're going to measure exactly what it takes to attack this. You're like, oh, okay, how do I acquire 51% of this hash power? Well, I need to be able to do this many exahashes per second. And you can say, like, okay, well, then I need to be able to make my own chips, and I need to build a factory, and you can sort of like start to price it out. Yeah.
So in general, the quote-unquote problems that have to be solved have to be like unforeseeable in advance and hard to do but easy to verify.
Yeah.
So does that exclude basically all real world?
Pretty much. Except that this is really useful for its own sake. I mean, we now have money that is not controlled by a single entity where you or I can transact without a trusted third party. If you want to think of the cost of gold, like gold mining is far more harmful to the earth. That's a nice example. If you want to think about what defends a currency, it's armies. So this seems much more palatable, but it's not perfect, that's for sure. Oh, yeah, so it's 8 o'clock now. I guess he's going to announce the end, but I'm going to stick around for more questions. If people want to stay and chat, you are more than welcome.
Yeah, so I'd like to thank Michael for this awesome presentation on Bitcoin.
Sure.